Welcome to Thundercast, Thunder Tech's podcast where we give you our take on what's new in marketing, what's cool, what's lame, and why you should care.
Hello and welcome to Thundercast, Thunder Tech's regular podcast. As always, I'm Craig Israel, Creative Director at Thunder Tech, and we have a very special episode of Thundercast today. We've recently released our annual trends publication where we explore some of the new and emerging trends in the marketing world. And we've been doing a series of podcasts where we discuss certain articles within the publication in a little bit more depth. And in this podcast, we're going to be talking about advertising's movement into the 21st century. And we have with me the article's authors, Jason Therrien, president of ThunderTech.
Howdy.
And JP Cranes, senior account manager and media specialist.
Hello.
So I'm super excited about this movement into the 21st century because I assume this means holograms and neural implants and flying cars. Am I right?
Yes, the podcast is done. Very good, Craig.
I wish. That'd be kind of cool, right?
Don't break my heart.
That's right. Send a hologram into your house, right?
And mm-hmm.
Get it done. Buy these tacos. Done. Jason and I, have a passion behind telling a good story to people, and this idea of moment marketing is a trend that we're seeing, and to us it kind of has a new feel to it. It's not something dramatically different, but it's a way of thinking that I think can go into the traditional and digital advertising that our clients are doing.
Right. I think that's correct. It's one more kind of methodology or just philosophy to add into the marketer's mix that if they think about their customers in the moment, they're going to be able to choose their marketing advertising mix more appropriately.
So we should define this, that there's been a lot of moments in the press over the last, couple years. So we're not talking micro moments like Google's talked about them.
No. Which we definitely think highly of that. That is a different type of a moment discussion. It does lend itself to the overall buying cycle, but this is much more particular. So when we talk about moments, let's define moment and then moment marketing. So the moment is really that point in time when a customer decides that they have a particular need, right? And they decide at that point, not just they've identified they have this need, but then they're willing to go do something about it.
So even though customers are bombarded with marketing messages all day long, this is that window when they actually raise their hand and say like, hey, can you help me?
Absolutely.
Yeah. And then, when it comes to moment marketing itself as a term, this is our ability to target our user through trackable media, right? So now we've identified that you have a need, and now we're giving you this opportunity to engage with whatever the medium is, right? It's traditional, it's digital, but it's a way to get you to an end. And from there, then we can track conversions and click-through rate and really engagement with that user. What you want to do is you want to say, we see the need that you have, now let's look to capitalize on that and report back with results.
So it's interesting, you mentioned traditional too. So in this digital advertising world we live in, you're not just talking about digital.
Yeah, I mean, I think, the predominant trend in this is with digital, and more folks are moving their advertising spend over to that medium. But, I think Jason and I would agree that ignoring some of the traditional methods with direct mail, print, among others, would be a little foolish. I think there's still a lot of need that our clients see in this traditional format and can act in this moment marketing phase just as well as I think digital can.
And you interviewed one of our clients in the resort and hotel space, and I was really interesting. I mean, I'm aware of their mix that they use with us of marketing tactics, but they did cite particular offline tactic that they use that works well in their moment. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, they use basically marriage mail, direct mail, in conjunction with their digital efforts. So AdWords, so PPC and search, some digital display, but then really hit it home with those direct mail pieces. So targeted by zip code and with promo codes. So we can kind of link them back and track that offline experience online.
When as I read the Trends magazine, it was interesting because they looked at it from a little wider perspective of vacation planning, that for their indoor water park, in this case, there's a particular time or times of the year when they know people are going to be doing vacation planning. So that allows them to do something maybe without the immediacy of digital, but it's still very targeted and confined, and they use mail to do that. So I thought that was a great example of, you know, not moving all the way into digital. There's still times for different industries where offline may be very appropriate with this philosophy.
Yeah, let me comment on that. I think it's easy to think of Moment as I'm standing in the supermarket in front of the cereal aisle and I'm reaching for a box of cereal, that's the moment. But what you guys are describing is something that's much, much broader, right? That the moment can be when I'm a mom gathering information about where to take my family over the summer.
Yeah, that's totally fair. And you know, one of the bullet points in the Trends magazine is understanding your audience. So you're exactly right to say, in some cases, this is not really an impulse. You know, it's something that we know that you're going to plan because you need some sort of family activity or you want to get everyone together. So you're like, okay, I'm going to plan this trip 2 months ahead. Well, there better be information in front of me so that when the season comes, I'm prepared with as much information as I can.
Yeah, so it's fascinating to think that the moment, even though it sounds spontaneous, can actually be, from a marketer standpoint, planned out months, years in advance.
Yeah, and it depends on your industry. So, but if you, to JP's point, if you put yourself in your buyer's shoes, you'll be able to understand when they have those moments and with what frequency and how they would then go about solving that moment. That's another thing. You know, perhaps it's a vacation where they're not looking to solve it, but you know these things happen at a certain period of time, so you need to be in front of them. They may then grab that mailer and move to their buyer journey online in terms of booking a room or researching rates. But there are plenty of other moments out there that, you know, it's a quicker need and it's a Google search or they pull up an app to ask a question or wherever it is. Again, it's raising their hand at that point saying, I need help. And can that marketer be there for them? So besides food, in addition to food, I think, you know, we've done this with food manufacturers and product companies that, you know, how do you make sure you're coming up with your product when people are researching recipes? If you're researching a recipe, you're in the moment. You're looking to prepare a meal typically. And that meal may be that night or it may be this weekend or maybe for a party you're throwing in a couple of weeks. But either way, that consumer is in the moment thinking about something they need to do. And again, lending itself to say, I'm going to be preparing this dish. Are you ready to give me your information and compel me to use maybe a recipe, but definitely product? I think there's also, JP and I talked about automotive. You know, there's been a movement into that space, certainly.
Yeah, you know, there are so many different stages, if you will, of the car buying process. There's the planning. You know, it's like, my car's a couple years old. You know, it's kind of failing on some certain parts. You know, maybe I should start looking for a car. Okay, so what's the trigger then that meets that audience member? Additionally, there's my car broke on the highway this morning and I need a new car tomorrow or else I won't be able to, you know, go grocery shopping or, you know, buy Van Halen tickets. So from there, it's right. You have two different, sort of processes in that cycle. So how do you make sure that your advertising has sort of these different levels to hit those different interests? And especially with automotive and car dealers in particular, there is a wide swath of people that are interested in brand and location and online deals and, you know, used cars. I mean, there's just so many different pieces. How do you get in front of that person with that specific message? That's, I think, the biggest part for any marketer, especially in the automotive business.
Right. And, you know, we've even talked about it with clients in the destination, entertainment, tourism space. And this can be not just planning a trip, but what to do while you're there, or if you're local, what to do this weekend, right? if you raise your hand to say, you know, give me a list of things happening in this city or happening downtown, or, you know, what's going on at the, you know, the, in the museum neighborhood, who's giving them that information? You know, and many times it's not the brand. It's they're reliant on others, and they haven't said, my customers are in that moment. I need to be there, and I maybe need to be there with a compelling argument too. Some it may be around discounting or couponing, and others it's just making sure you're ranking well or coming up at that point in time.
Right. So it sounds like there's, for most businesses, most brands, there's not a single moment for their customers, right? There's a spectrum of moments. So does that mean the savvy business is trying to blanket all the possible moments and make sure that they're always there when any of their customers raise their hand?
Yeah, I mean, from my point of view, you can't, you know, focus on one moment, and one moment alone is, you know, putting all your eggs in one basket. You know, because for whatever reason, the audience doesn't respond the way you intend. That's sort of a do or die type mentality. On the flip side, though, I think trying to engage in every single moment creates just nothing more than just white noise. If you're liking and sharing and pushing everything through because you think you should be a part of it, then you're really confusing the message, right? It's like one friend that you knew in high school on Facebook that posts every single day. You're like, okay, I could do one a month maybe from you and that would be fine. But every single day, it's, you know, like, okay, this is, you know, hide. But I think, you know, the philosophy of that can be helpful to brands. And really, if there's a moment that equates to success for the brand, you should go after it. And you just try to find your spots. And there's some trial and error that goes into it. But I think finding your key moments is critical.
Another client that we interviewed in the magazine article is in the heavy duty equipment space in the transportation field. So, you know, when they sell, they may sell in a very much a B2B fashion. They may sell to fleet owners, to owner operators, to municipalities and governments. I mean, it's just a wide range. So their moments per customer, they think about why they would then come to this organization. And there's a variety of reasons why. And they try to, again, just meet enough of them and then serve them at that moment with enough information. So they believe that their differentiator in the moment is over-serving the customer, giving them not just the basics information, but so much information that they just take the barriers down and make it easy to then buy their product or continue the relationship offline through a phone call or a visit. And, you know, to me, that's an excellent idea that you maybe can't define 100 or 1,000 different moment types. Maybe you can talk about the major ones, but being ready for when the customer is in it and how you need to serve them so that they don't wander off, I think is almost as critical.
Right. And that's, I mean, that's in conjunction with the branding work they do offline, correct?
Yes. Yes. So great point, JP. I think that we probably should have started the podcast off with this, but, you know, marketing in the moment is not to be confused with branding and exercises in advertising that keep a brand top of mind. You know, there is a place for that, and I think every industry and brand needs to figure out what that percentage is. We've seen that percentage shrink over time. So in this case, this B2B group, they still do trade publication advertising. They were a big player in a lot of the magazines they used to do, and they would literally take out anywhere between 12 and 20 pages worth of advertising some months. I mean, they were a major player. They didn't stop that, but today that's down to 2 to 4 pages with a bigger push to go online. They've taken those dollars, invested them more into ranking well and being there in the moment, especially through search, and then providing a better experience through all their online properties. They don't have to have 20 pages to be considered anymore.
So the brand mention is incredibly important, because if I'm there, if I'm a brand, I'm there for you in the moment. If I don't know you and I don't trust you, I'm not going to pull the trigger just because you happen to be the first one
to
show up.
Yes. Couldn't have said that better.
So do you guys think you can force the moment on a customer, or can you only sit and anticipate and be there when the customer's ready?
I think that's a very fair question. I think most people can sniff out when I'm being marketed to, if you will. One of the examples that I've seen, which I thought was very well done, and it sounds kind of easy, but the concept of it was kind of really sharp and really within what we're talking about. There was a company that geo-targeted a location filled with bars and restaurants. And they were able to geo-target a specific bar or restaurant, create a radius target around there, and then feed the folks that were in that radius advertising. So for example, in this case, it was a vodka company that had actually paid for the ads. And if you were coming out of the bar or in the vicinity and you picked up your phone, whether you were in an app or in your browser, you were served an ad saying, you know, welcome to, you know, Party Street.
This Party Street, my favorite.
That's right, yeah. This is...
it's in the corner of Electric Boogaloo and... sorry.
And you could see on your phone, you know, this vodka company is giving you a free Uber ride. So you come out of the bar, maybe you were a tad overserved. You know, you come out there, you open your phone, you're starting to read text or whatever, you get online and you go, wow, look at this, they got served an Uber. Guess what, I need one, and so does my friend, and so do they. And all of a sudden you go, wow, that's really convenient. And it was nothing more than just targeting that advertising to an area that they knew would have great visibility, it was relevant to them in the moment, and they were able to track it because there was the code and the interaction that came back and forth. So it's that type of example, I think, is really strong for that concept of having the need and then hitting them with that moment marketing piece.
Well, that seems like one of those basics where, you know, every company we work with, how do you tighten up your marketing or advertising spend? You know, not everybody out there needs to know about you, but can the right people know about you? And can they know about you at the right time? So in this case, on Party Street, we're going to go visit later. You know, I'm assuming they're spending those dollars during the evening hours and the weekend. Great. Doesn't have to be served at 8 a.m. That's just a waste of money. You know, unless they have a special permit, I guess,
where
you can serve at 8 a.m. But, you know, it's really interesting where, again, it's not rocket science, just a different way of thinking about it and getting more into those personas of your customers and understanding what their triggers are and when and why they would think of you.
So in the article, you both have written about four steps for your ad strategy for the 21st century. And I think we've already discussed most of these, but to recap and to go through these four, you know, let's start with number one, trial approach.
Right. So we're big believers in experimentation and trial and test and learn and test and defend too. So you don't have to shift to this 100%, you know, make a move into it, set aside a trial and start there and measure it.
When I look at any sort of trial that we put together, you have to understand the audience. I think in everything we do, we could talk to whoever we want to, but we got to make sure it's the right person. So that trial approach really allows for success or failure to be on a smaller scale to see how we can kind of push that together and make it a far more impactful piece. The next ones are picking that measurable moment. You know, Craig and I, we talked about that as... is if you're part of everything, then you're sort of white noise and you're in the background. So you got to like pick your spots and really look to emphasize where you want to belong. And then that last point is tie the results to business logic, right? What does a success look like? If I was to tell you I can deliver, let's just take the prior example, you know, 10 Uber rides, is that good? Or is that just not going to work because it's just not scaled enough for us to make an impact? So before we proceed with these execution, it's important to know what success and failure looks like so we can have the right heft behind it to make it work.
So I like the notion that if you're following these four steps, that that you're future-proofing your marketing strategy. Now, I mean, that's a bit of exaggeration. No one can 100% future-proof anything because, you know, people are whimsical and they change their minds. But it sounds like if you follow these steps, at least you have good business logic, you know your audience, you know, you're testing and defending and gathering information, that this is as close as we can get to have campaigns that are always going to be successful.
Agreed. I couldn't have said that better. It's really understanding, again, why a consumer, no matter what you're selling, why they need you and when they need you. And taking what you're probably already doing, that's the thing, is that this isn't anything new. You're probably doing some mix of this. But if you trial it and test more of it, you may find what that mix is or how it is more effective and pull the levers a little stronger or quicker on some of these because you're finding that you're ending up in these moments and they're doing very well because you're meeting them at that cross-section of when they have the need and when they're ready to buy from you.
That cross-section of Electric Avenue and Party Street.
Yes.
Yes. Exactly. See you there in 10.
But like to build off of that, it's you know, if you do a trial approach to this and you say, you know, this seems like I could do more of this, right? We understand that our clients specifically don't have unlimited budget and people and time and all those other things. So, you know, a lot of the big players are looking to automate a lot of these processes, you know. So, for example, if they run TV advertising, what's the trigger that pushes a digital ad to your iPad? So some of the research that we've seen shows that you know, close to 67% of brands are planning to spend more on digital campaigns triggered by offline events. So offline event could be, you know, anything from weather to sporting events, the stock market, that those happen and then all of a sudden an ad gets pushed out, whether that's, you know, matching it with TV shows, any of the television advertising that some of the big players throw out there, they want to be in front of those folks when they reach for the iPhone, when they reach for the iPad. And typically, it's pretty quick. It's triggered usually within 10 seconds. And I'm sure that all of us in here have picked up an iPad and go, yeah, you know, I want to learn more about that to kind of get there. So there's that immediacy and quickness that some of the big players are doing. But I think some of those pieces can be helpful to even the smallest client to kind of scale it down to their level.
So you mentioned marketing automation, and I'd like to mention that if you, the listening audience, wants to know more about it, you can go back to episode number 20, Marketing Automation, where we talk to our marketing automation specialist about this topic in depth. And if you want to know more about advertising, moment advertising, advertising in the 21st century, what we've been talking about here today, pick up our trends book. It's available now at thundertech.com/trends. You can download the PDF, or if you're dying for the beautiful print edition, you can reach out to us at our website, thundertech.com, and we'll get a physical copy in your sweaty mitts. As always, if you like what you heard on this podcast, subscribe. Yeah, you can find us on iTunes or Stitcher or wherever you purchase your podcasts. And you can always tweet at us at ThunderTech. Special thanks to our guests, Jason and JP. Thanks for the conversation, gentlemen.
Absolutely.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
Appreciate it.
And we'll catch you next time.